Good morning. Welcome to Camelback Bible Church. We're glad you guys could make it, even on a holiday weekend. We're so glad you're here, and we know that this season has been confusing and difficult, but we've had a lot of people start to watch our services and connect online, and then some of you visiting now in the past couple of weeks. And so we wanted to encourage you to join the family. If you aren't already, we have the opportunity to go through membership class starting next Sunday on the 13th, and it's going to be over Zoom. And so you can register online either through our church website, you can email me directly, and I'll make sure you get the link. My email is acaswell@camelbackbible.com, and I would just encourage you guys to join us if you haven't already. We'd love to have you a part of our ministry and to serve and continue to make that commitment and have the elders commit to serving you as well. Second announcement I have is women's kickoff is this Thursday. So ladies, if you haven't already, make sure you register. We have a great speaker in Kathleen Nielsen. This is going to be online, and this is going to be the first of their book studies on Thursday evenings. And so it's a great opportunity to connect with other women in the church, to go through a book study together, and this Thursday is the kickoff for that. And then lastly, I just want to continue to encourage you that we have a couple of staff positions open, and so be praying for us. First, we have the Contemporary Worship Director. The Contemporary Worship Director is a search that we've been doing for the last few months, obviously a little bit difficult in this season of COVID, but we've had some great candidates apply. The team is doing a great job going through and interviewing those candidates. We're still accepting applications, so we encourage, if you know somebody, or just to be praying for that as we continue the search and be praying as we look to find the candidate to be our new leader in this service for the long future. And then the second is, many of you know that Wes Kenyon has been serving in an administrative role in the church office for about 9 months now. And part of his role, a lot of his responsibilities, in fact, have been helping to maintain the facilities. And hopefully you notice the improvements that have come over the last few months, especially when you've returned after our season of kind of a shutdown. And now we are ready to hire a full-time facilities director and to take on those responsibilities from Wes. And so be praying as we begin that search over this week and pray that we have someone to fill that role soon. As we begin to consider those things and the ministry that we're doing here at Camelback, we want to encourage you to stand together and to worship God together as we join our voices as one.
Power of sin. Let's pray together, and you can sit down. And we're so thankful for what God has done for us, and we always say, worthy is the Lamb who is slain. And it's because Jesus carried our sin on the cross and brought us back to God that we can come to Him in prayer. And so let's do that. Lord, we thank You so much that You are a God of truth. And we praise You this morning as the God of truth. We've had people lie to us, and we don't know what to believe in the media. And then we come to You. And the psalmist says that the words of the Lord are pure words, like silver refined in a furnace. You don't shade the truth to Your advantage. You don't leave out important details that we need to hear. There are no lies, no spin, no slippery evasions. But Lord, You're perfectly truthful, and Your word is perfectly true. And so we praise You for Your honesty, Your faithfulness, Your dependability, Your integrity. And even as we do, Lord, we see our own sin all the more clearly, especially our own lies and deceit. Lord, we confess to You that we have deceived others, sometimes subtly, and sometimes with outright lies. We confess to You that we've deceived ourselves. We want so desperately to think well of ourselves, that we're good people, that we push aside the truth, that we suppress things that don't look good so that we can think well of ourselves. We tell ourselves lies. And Lord, we deceive with our lives. We are hypocrites. We take the name of Christ, we call ourselves the people of God, and then all too often we don't live that way. So Lord, we confess our sins to You. And we thank You that we can come to the gospel and find forgiveness again. How much we need a Savior. Lord, we're so thankful that You died on the cross to carry our sins, and You rose again to give us life. Your word says that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. And that's exactly what You've done. You've saved us. And we thank You, and we count on that again today. Lord, because You are a God of truth, a God of integrity, faithfulness, You are completely dependent, we can bring our prayer requests before You, and we do that now. We pray for our church family, for those who are grieving, for Ray Hoffman, who passed away just this past week, for others who are remembering a hard anniversary right around now, for those who have lost a loved one in the past couple months and are still grieving and very wounded and raw, we pray for grace. Lord, we pray for those who are ill and recovering, that You'll meet each one. We pray, Lord, that as a church family, we would speak the truth in love to each other, that we would care for each other in gentle relationships, that we would build each other up. We pray, Lord, for honesty and integrity in our church family to shine in this world that's full of lies. Lord, we thank You so much for the generosity of the Camelback family and how we've been able to make our budget so far this year and end last year well. And Lord, we thank You that because You are a God who is utterly truthful, we can trust Your promises. And when we give to the gospel, we know that You see and You reward and that You will care for us. Lord, we pray for our city of Phoenix and the valley, this region. Lord, we pray for the COVID pandemic, that You will suppress the cases and be with those who have COVID, and that You will be with medical personnel who are caring for people. We pray for city officials who have to make all sorts of decisions on our behalf, from budget to long-range planning, to zoning regulations, all the different things that they do. We pray for wisdom and skill and grace for them and their work. For small business owners, who are really hurting at this point in the pandemic, 6 months into it. We pray that you will bring relief, that you'll provide, and that you'll give hope when it's very difficult at this point. Lord, we pray that we would be witnesses for the gospel, and that the gospel would grow in our community. Lord, there are so many hot spots around the world, whether it's in Belarus with the peaceful uprisings or in relationship with China and Taiwan and other areas. We pray for peace in our world, and we pray that the Prince of Peace, you, Lord Jesus, would come quickly. And finally, Lord, we pray for the person who's here this morning seeking truth, for the woman, for the man, the student, who is looking for what is true and reliable, what they can believe and count on. We pray that you'd give them ears to hear your word today. Help them to believe. Help them to have life. Pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Father, we just come to you this morning. God, we ask that you would change our hearts. God, that use this time to mold us into more of the image of your Son. God, would you help us to come in line with your vision and your truth, God? God, would you teach us and would you lead us? Have your way in this time. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thanks, guys. Well, we're going to be looking at the beginning of the Sermon on the Mount. We did an overview last week. So go ahead and open your Bibles up to Matthew chapter 5, or pull out your phone and pull up Matthew chapter 5. We're going to be looking at verses 1 through 12 today, the Beatitudes. So if you've got that open, let's read that together. Matthew chapter 5. Seeing the crowds, Jesus went up on the mountain, and when he sat down, his disciples came to him. And he opened his mouth and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you." Lord, thank you so much for your word. And we hear it, and it's challenging. We want to understand it and believe it, hold on to it, and live it. And we pray that you'll give us the grace to do that. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, when I was a kid at camp in northern Wisconsin, I learned to skip rocks with my friends in my cabin. And Long Lake was a perfect place to do that because there were all sorts of flat weathered rocks on the shore. And the waves on Long Lake were little more than glorified ripples. So it was a perfect place to send a rock skimming across the surface. And I found with a smooth stone and a good throw that we could usually get 6-7 times or more of these skips. And you know how it works. The first one is always really big, and then the next one's a little bit smaller, and then the last couple ones are do-do-do-do-do before it finally sinks into the water. And there's really something, even now, there's something magical and really wonderful and strangely satisfying about skipping a rock. Come on, you guys, you know that that's true. Yeah, okay, we get it. Well, many people skim across the surface of God's word like a smooth rock on a lake. They touch briefly, but they don't engage meaningfully with what God says. They stay on the surface of the Bible and never go deeper. Or rather, the Bible never goes deeper into them. Now, I mention that because it's tempting to skip across the Beatitudes, to skim right along the top of them. For one thing, they're challenging, and they're counterintuitive, and they seem paradoxical. And frankly, they seem a little bit unrealistic and out of touch with reality. I mean, who really lives this way? You can see it as a lofty ideal, but nobody actually does it. And so someone could be like a visitor in an art gallery as they read the Beatitudes. They appreciate Jesus' moral vision, his spiritual ideals, but then they leave and return to the real world. But here's the thing. Jesus is describing normal Christianity here. This is what it means to follow Jesus. It's not a description of just the great Christian leaders like John Piper or Kathleen Nielsen, who's going to be speaking at our women's fall kickoff. Jesus is describing everyone who is a child of God. When you enter his kingdom, these radical, counterintuitive, paradoxical blessings become your experience. So let's notice a few things about the Beatitudes in general. First, every Beatitude is for every Christian. Every Beatitude is for every Christian. Sometimes you might think of the Beatitudes the way you think of spiritual gifts, right? Nobody has all the spiritual gifts. Some have the gift of teaching, some have the gift of mercy, some have, you know, the gift of administration, some have other gifts. But no one has them all. And so you might think of the Beatitudes that way too. Well, this person mourns, and I'm called to be pure, and that person's a peacemaker, and we kind of slice and divide them up between all the different people in the church. But that's not the way it is. They're like eight facets of one diamond. They describe each person in God's kingdom. All the Beatitudes are for all Christians. Another thing to notice, just in general, is that the Holy Spirit produces the Beatitudes in our lives through the gospel. The gospel is what does this to us and makes us like this. If you notice, up to this point in Matthew, the only thing that Jesus has preached is the gospel, the good news that God's kingdom had arrived. And when he begins to preach then, he describes the blessings of those who have responded to this message. If you notice carefully, you'll see that the Beatitudes aren't commands, they're descriptions. He doesn't tell us, mourn. He doesn't say, be meek. He doesn't say, be persecuted. He says that those who are this way are blessed. And that's an important, subtle distinction. The key to experiencing the Beatitudes is not to check them off a list, although it's certainly important to be conscious of them. The key to experiencing the Beatitudes is to focus on the gospel, and the gospel will do these things in your life. If you've experienced God's mercy, you will become merciful. If you've seen your own sin in the gospel, you will mourn, and you'll be poor in spirit. If God has made peace with you, you're going to be able to make peace with others. See, the gospel is what produces the Beatitudes in our lives. So that becomes even clearer when we notice the first word for each one of them, blessed. Blessed is, blessed are. Blessed doesn't mean happy. It means that God is for us. The opposite of blessed isn't unhappy. The opposite of blessed is cursed. By nature, we were all cursed because of our sin. We had turned against God and become his enemies. But when you turn to follow Jesus, your sins are forgiven through his death and resurrection, and God is for you. He accepts you as his own, and he blesses you. So the gospel is what allows these blessings to come to us. Jesus spoke these Beatitudes, and the gospel blessings they promise come through him. All of God's blessings come through Christ, and there's no blessing without him. Then notice the shape of the Beatitudes. What do they actually look like? Best way to picture them is like a set of stairs, and they each build one on the other. They lead us from the basement of our need, blessed are the poor in spirit, all the way up to the top step of being so much like Christ that we're treated like him in this world. Blessed are you when you're persecuted for righteousness' sake. Each one follows the other. And we can also arrange the Beatitudes into two sets of four. The first four Beatitudes focus on our deep need before God, and the last four describe our lives when we've been satisfied by God. And so we can call the first four Beatitudes the blessings of emptiness, and the last four the blessings of fullness. So some powerful words here. And I want to encourage us, as we think about each one of these in turn, let's not skim across the surface of God's word like a flat stone on a lake. We want to go deeper into these challenging words. We want these challenging words to go deeper into us. So first, the blessings of emptiness. We're starting in the basement of spiritual need. And the first step is to be poor in spirit. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Now, he's not talking about physical poverty. We've all seen homeless people on the street. But those who are poor in spirit may fly in corporate jets just as easily as they might sleep on the sidewalk. This is spiritual poverty. To be poor in spirit is to realize that we are destitute before God. You and I have absolutely nothing to offer him. This is the absolute opposite of religion. Religion is a contract. When you come to God as a religious person, you come to him saying, I'm going to do this for you, and you're going to do this for me. I do Christian things. I serve, I give. I go to church, I read my Bible, I meet with my community group, I do these spiritual Christian things for God, and then he takes care of these other things for me and gives me the life that I want. Kids and career, health, home and happiness, rewards, retirement. It's a contract. That's the mindset of religion. And think about what happens if hard things happen when you're a religious person. If hard things happen in your life, then someone broke the contract. Either I didn't keep my part of the bargain, and I didn't do enough, or else God betrayed me, and he didn't keep up his part of the bargain. And so as a result, when trouble comes, I'm angry at God for letting me down, or I'm angry at myself for not doing enough. I hate thee, or I hate me. So if I'm coming to God with a religious contract mentality, the way I feel about myself swings between pride and depression. When things are going well, I'm very proud because that's evidence that I've done what I'm supposed to do and I'm a good person. And when things go poorly, when things go wrong, then I'm depressed and I'm desperate and I have to do more. This is a trap. This is a treadmill. This will drain the life out of you. And the first beatitude does away with the religion. Blessed are the poor in spirit. There is no contract here. There can be no contract here. We're not coming to God as equals. We're coming to God as people who are absolutely destitute. We have nothing to offer him. Everything we have is his already anyway. The psalmist says, speaking for God, I have no need of a bull from your stall or of goats from your pens, for every animal of the forest is mine, and the cattle on 1,000 hills. I know every bird in the mountains, and the insects in the fields are mine. If I were hungry, I wouldn't tell you, for the world is mine and all that is in it. Spiritual poverty, knowing that we are unworthy, is essential for coming to God. This means that if I'm going to come to God, if I'm going to respond to the gospel, one of the things that I've done is I've given up on my own goodness. I realize that I'm powerless to please him. And this is something that grows the longer you walk with Christ. This is how it is when you start, and Godly believers who have been walking with Jesus for decades, they see their own poverty more than they ever did. I remember thinking I was a pretty good person still when I was saved. And then you go on living, and you go on following, and you go on stumbling, and you realize, oh goodness, I really do have nothing to give to God. Absolutely nothing. The Beatitudes, the first step of the Beatitudes is for you, whether you're a new believer or whether you've been walking with him for years and years and years. The second step of the Beatitudes is blessed sorrow. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. And so we ask ourselves the question, well, mourn what? What are they mourning? Well, if the first Beatitude is about spiritual poverty, the second refers to mourning for sin. If you follow Jesus, you're grieved by sin wherever you see it. You're grieved by sin in the world and by the way it breaks relationships and hurts families and sets parents against children and children against parents and husbands and wives against each other, the way it hurts our society and our nation. And most of all, you're grieved over the sin that you see in your own heart. And you see, you say to yourself, I'm just shocked by what I'm capable of. I'm shocked by what I see and think and do sometimes. I'm horrified. And I mourn. The Russian poet Turgenev said this, I don't know what the heart of a bad man is like, but I know what the heart of a good man is like, and it's terrible. We mourn. And the longer we go with Christ, the more clearly we see our own sin, and we mourn. And God comforts us with the gospel. Those who mourn are comforted. The gospel tells us that Christ saves us from the penalty and the power and the presence of sin. He saves us from the penalty of our sin. Jesus took our punishment on the cross. He saves us from the power of sin. The power of sin has been broken in our lives. And we have the Holy Spirit to give us strength to love him and obey him. And the presence of sin. One of the greatest things about heaven is going to be waking up and realize that this darkness that we've experienced our entire lives in our heart is gone. What a glorious day that will be. And so those who mourn over their own sin and the sin they see in the world will be comforted. That's the promise of the Beatitudes. The third step in the Beatitudes, the third blessing of emptiness, blessed gentleness. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Now the word meek, okay. It doesn't mean weak or wimpy, but it has a sense of self-control and gentle strength. I was trying to think of a picture of this week as I was thinking about meekness. And I had a picture in my mind of a big old St. Bernard. My friend Rob Schaller had a big St. Bernard named Brutus when I was growing up. And that dog was massive. So I was picturing a big St. Bernard, and there's a little poodle running around yapping at that St. Bernard. And that St. Bernard just completely ignores him. He doesn't get riled up. Why? Because he's a big dog. And he knows that he's okay, and he doesn't have to prove it to this little poodle. That's meekness. It's gentle strength. We have no power in ourselves. We're elect exiles. We're vulnerable in this world. We're often persecuted, and yet we can be meek because just like that big dog knows that he's got strength, we've got a big God taking care of us. And so we can afford to be gentle. Blessed are the meek. Interestingly, this beatitude is a direct quote from Psalm 37. And in Psalm 37, the psalmist is encouraging those who are suffering under evildoers to commit their way to the Lord and refrain from anger and not to be worried and anxious. And he follows this with a promise. This is Psalm 37, 10 and 11. In just a little while, the wicked will be no more. Though you look carefully at his place, he will not be there. But the meek, here's our beatitude, but the meek shall inherit the land or the earth and delight themselves in abundant peace. Now, what's significant about that? What's significant about that is that David was writing this psalm when the people of Israel were already in the promised land. And so when he talks about inheriting the land, they had already inherited the land. He is talking about a greater land. He is talking about inheriting heaven. And we saw this very same thing in 1 Peter when we were going through 1 Peter this summer. We have an inheritance in heaven that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading that's being kept for you. You don't have to get worked up when things go wrong in this world. You can be meek because you have an inheritance and you have a great big God that's taking care of you and making sure that you receive it. Gentle strength because you believe God's promises. And the fourth beatitude promises blessing for the hungry. Verse 6, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Jesus talks about hunger and thirst to show us how intensely we should crave righteousness. 3 weeks ago, I met with my surgeon, and she's a very nice, lovely British lady. And at the end of our appointment, she said to me, "Oh, and one more thing, Mr. Johnston. I noticed from your chart and from looking at you that you're a bit fluffy around the middle." She did, no lie. "And I'd like you to lose weight before the surgery." So for these past 3-4 weeks, I've been trying to lose weight, can you tell? And probably not. And so I've been hungry quite a bit. Hungering, thirsting for righteousness, I get that. And if you're working outdoor in summer in Arizona, you understand thirst. We need water. So this is actually something we can feel viscerally, hungering and thirsting for righteousness. What are we craving when we say we hunger and thirst for righteousness? Well, the basic idea of righteousness in the Bible is to be right with God. We want a right relationship with Him. That means that whatever is standing between us needs to be taken care of so that we can have a relationship. And that means that the way I live pleases Him to maintain that relationship. The first part, getting rid of the obstacles, the Bible talks about as justification. And then the second part, living to please Him, the Bible talks about as sanctification. And both of those are in play here when it talks about hungering and thirsting for righteousness. We want that right relationship with God. If anything's come, we want to get rid of it, and we want to live in a way that maintains it. Martin Lloyd-Jones, great pastor, said this: "It seems to me that righteousness here includes not only justification, but sanctification also. In other words, the desire for righteousness, the act of hungering and thirsting for it, means ultimately the desire to be free from sin in all its forms and every manifestation. We want nothing to stand between us and God. And we hunger and thirst for that kind of relationship with Him. The blessings of emptiness, the blessings of our need, walking up from the basement of spiritual poverty." And that brings us to the last four, the blessings of fullness. And these focus on being satisfied by God's presence, by God's goodness to us. God promises blessing to the merciful. Verse 7, "Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy." Now, this isn't a quid pro quo. I'm merciful to others, and therefore God is merciful to me. That's not what's going on here. Jesus is setting out the same principle that He's going to teach later in the parable of the unforgiving servant, Matthew 18. Do you remember that parable? There was a servant who owed his master a ton of money. I tried to do a purchasing power parity and kind of bring it up in today's terms to how much money the guy owed. And it comes out, according to my calculations, to something like $4.8 billion with a B. And he went to the master and he said, "I can't possibly pay this back. Have mercy on me." And the master forgave him $4.8 billion. And then he goes out and he finds another servant who owes him $9,600. And he chokes him and he throws him in prison until he pays. And the master heard about this and said this, "You wicked servant, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. And should not you have had mercy on your fellow servant as I had mercy on you?" Well, what's the basic principle here? It's easy to see. If God has been merciful to us, then we can and should be merciful to others. And if I have not experienced, if I'm not merciful to others, the corollary is, it may very well be that I haven't experienced God's mercy for myself. Forgiven people forgive people. The Holy Spirit produces the Beatitudes in us through the gospel. We feel God's mercy. We know just how little we deserve it. And then when someone hurts us, we say, you know what? I didn't deserve to have Christ be so good to me. I'm going to be the same to you. And that puts us in a cycle of blessing. We receive God's mercy, we show God's mercy, and then we receive more mercy. That's the promise of this beatitude. So the question is, am I merciful? Am I merciful to immigrants and to the poor? Am I merciful to those who are in the grips of drugs and alcohol? Am I merciful to those who look different than me? Am I merciful to those who don't have good manners? Am I merciful to someone who's wronged me or hurt me? Children being merciful to parents with long wounds from a long time ago. Parents merciful toward children who have betrayed them. Am I merciful to those who disagree with me politically? If I've been forgiven, I can forgive others. If I received God's mercy, his mercy will flow to others through me. And here's the thing. If I cannot and will not show mercy, if I cannot and will not forgive, then I need to step back and say, have I truly experienced God's mercy for myself? Am I truly saved? It's a sobering question. God's blessing to the pure is the next beatitude. Verse 8, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. A pure heart is an undivided heart. Picture an arrow shooting in one direction. A pure heart is spotless without sin because it's pursuing Christ. And we need this sort of purity. I remember once, I think I was in college, maybe I was in seminary, I was carrying a pen in my pocket, and you know what happened next. It was one of those blue Bic pens, and it began to leak, and I looked down, and I had this huge blue spot on my shirt. That shirt that was once clean now is stained, and that's the way our lives are. We need to be washed clean, we need to be purified, and that's why we need Jesus. The Bible tells us that Jesus gave himself for us to redeem us from all lawlessness and to purify for himself a people for his own possession who are zealous for good works. Purity. Now notice the promise that comes with this. Blessed are the pure in heart. Why? For they shall see God. If you don't love God, then being in God's presence and seeing him isn't going to be all that motivating. You're going to read this beatitude and say, okay, yeah, what's the big deal? Why bother being pure? I mean, what's the big deal about seeing God? But if you love him, then seeing him is what you want most of all. That's what the psalmist said. One thing I ask of the Lord, this will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. What a promise. And it's given to the pure in heart. The seventh beatitude calls us to work for peace. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. And here again, we can hear the gospel working in our hearts. God has made peace with us, and so we can make peace with other people. And when we do make peace with others, we look like our Father in heaven, because that's what he does with us. The scriptures say that when we were enemies, We were reconciled to God by the death of Jesus, his son. God is the ultimate peacemaker. And those who act like him in this world will be known as his children. The last beatitude is also the longest. It's stated in verse 10 and then elaborated in verses 11 and 12. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice, be glad, for your reward is great in heaven, for so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. Now let's be clear what kind of persecution that he's talking about. He's not talking about persecution because you're difficult or ornery. You know, you deserve that. He's not talking about people getting mad at you because of your politics. That's not what he's talking about here either. This persecution is for righteousness, a right relationship with God through Jesus Christ. No one really cares if you say all religions are the same. And as long as you're trying as a good purpose, as a good person, you're going to be all right with God. No one is going to care. No one's going to blink if you say that. They won't cancel you. But if you say that Jesus Christ is the only way to God, you will get pushback. If you say Jesus is the Son of God who died and rose again for sinners and only he can make you right with God, you can expect trouble. And that's the sort of persecution you're going to get for righteousness' sake. Jesus himself was persecuted for saying that he's the Son of God and for healing the sick and forgiving sins and doing good things. And if you follow him, even if you're doing good things, you can expect to be treated just like he was. But with that comes a blessing. It has always been that way for God's people. Even the prophets in the Old Testament experienced that very thing. It wasn't any easier then than it is now. There's really nothing new under the sun. This age is no harder or easier than previous ages. You'll experience it. But it's a blessing because even the world is testifying that you look like Jesus. Well, I was about 10 or 12 years old when I learned to skip rocks up at Honey Rock Camp. Let's not skim across the surface of God's word this morning. The blessings of emptiness confront us with our need. So ask yourself these questions. Do I see that I have nothing to offer God? This is what it means to be poor in spirit. Does my sin grieve me? Do God's promises give me gentle strength? Am I meek? Am I hungry for righteousness? Do I crave desperately to be right with God? Then the blessings of fullness that transform our lives. Am I merciful because God's merciful to me? Am I pure? Has God purified my life? Am I keeping myself pure to please him? Have I experienced God's peace for myself so that I'm making peace with others? If you do all this, you're going to be so much like Jesus that the world will treat you like it treated him. And all of this is ours through the gospel. The more we ponder and treasure and understand what God has done for us in Jesus Christ and think through the implications of what that says about me, and how little goodness I have, and what a great Savior he is, and how patient he is with me, and the good future that he has promised to me, the more I ponder the gospel and what it means for my life, the more these Beatitudes will be my experience and yours too. We don't want Jesus' words to stay on the surface of our lives. We want Jesus' words to go deep in our hearts this morning. And I pray that that's true for you. Lord, we thank you for these Beatitudes, these counterintuitive, radical, revolutionary, unlikely, paradoxical blessings. But, oh Lord, precious blessings to those of us who know you. To the man, the woman, the student, the child that's here today and has never really understood what it means to be a Christian, that it's all about being poor in spirit, and it's not about doing what we have to do to earn God's favor and make things right ourselves. I pray that today you'll give them the grace and the faith to believe in Jesus and to give up trying to rely on their own goodness, but to say, you know what, I have nothing in my hands. All I can do is trust you. Pray today that you'll give them life. And for all of us, Lord, as we think about all that you have done for us, as we follow you as our King, may these Beatitudes be more and more and more our experience. Amen.
Life.
haven't shared communion together since March. April, May, June, July, August, September. It has been 6 months since we shared the Lord's table together. That's a long time. And I've missed it. I've missed the bread and the cup with you affirming our faith together. So today is a huge day for us because half a year ago was the last time we took communion. Today, in order to do this, we're going to be dismissing rows by row to go back. There's two stations in the back, and there's two cups. You'll notice that the bottom cup has a little wafer in it, and the top cup has the juice. So just grab a little, one of the little two packs, and prayerfully reflect, and you can just take communion right back there where you are, and then afterwards, you can leave the cups back there and come back to your seat. Let me read what the Bible tells us about this. This is something that points us back to Jesus' death and resurrection, so it's a wonderful thing for us to be doing, thinking about the Beatitudes, because it's helping us to focus on the gospel that creates the Beatitudes in our lives. So the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." So as you eat the little piece of wafer, symbolic bread, remember his body broken for you, and that it took his death on the cross for the forgiveness of your sins. And after they shared the entire Passover meal, he took the cup, which was probably the fourth cup of that meal, and said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." It's a covenant. It's a promise that he has made with you to save you completely and fully and bring you safely home. Lord, as we share this bread and this cup together, communion, half a year ago was the last time, and here we are again today. What a good thing. I pray that each one of us, as we move forward and share this symbolic meal together, will once again ponder and think about and understand and treasure all that you have done for us. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
confess. Bowing here, I find my rest. And without you, I fall apart. You're the one who guides my
my way.
Fake me out there. I started to walk up before you were done. Blessing for today comes from Numbers. This is what the priests in the Old Testament used to say to bless God's people, and it's good for us today too. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace.